I've been working on this open source project for over 2.5 years. 2.5 years is a bit of a while, but compared to the age of the CPU it's using, it's an amazing 20 times less, since we're finally celebrating the 50-year anniversary of the MOS technology 6502 CPUs you know and love from the Commodore machines, Apple 1 and 2s, Atari's, Nintendo Entertainment System, and so many others. The 6502 CPU doesn't actually turn 50 until September, but that won't stop me from going all in on using it for a ton of fun projects until then. So today I have some pretty cool things to announce, if you like really old retro dogs learning some new tricks at least. This is the 6502ino. And you might have heard I gave it a bunch of new features back in January, like onboard serial, USB-C, new interfacing options, and even the option to choose between a range of clock speeds depending on how much you feel like overclocking the overwhelming default clock speed of 1 MHz. It also got a software upgrade with a code monitor, so you technically don't need another computer to enter in 6502 assembly code, a game, and a menu system. You can also assemble the ROM with support for my relatively universal ROM programmer if you like, but that's a whole other story. It's a 100% open source project, both the software and the hardware design files, so you're free to make your own or modify it. But I do also sell it on my webshop, and it went out of stock way too fast. So I thought I'd use that as an opportunity to make it even better. So I jumped over to JLCPCB, and luckily they were up for sending me the new and improved batch as a sponsorship. JLCPCB provides easy, affordable, and reliable PCB and PCB assembly solutions, empowering electronics engineers to develop projects efficiently. And that's not just something I'm saying to be nice. I've used them for many years before being sponsored for the first time. It's so easy to use the website, and over the years, they've been super helpful if I've gone beyond the design rules, and it's been a lot of fun learning PCB design and manufacturing with them as a partner. If you're new to JLCPCB, you can get a PCB for just $2 and also get $70 worth of coupons. And even if you're not a new customer, they have an amazing $30 off deal for 6-layer top quality PCBs with via in pad and everything for just $5. Super easy to use, super affordable, and super reliable every time. This time, I had the PCBs manufactured, including both the SMD components and the sockets. Since most people ordered the last revision with sockets and integrated circuits on the side anyway, I thought I might as well save everyone the trouble of hand soldering the 96 socket joints. That also has the added benefit, I can just take the dips from the previous version and have it run 6502 code without even turning on the iron. Zero solder 6502. And we can see the onboard LED is happily blinking. I didn't add the pin sockets for the Arduino compatible headers though, so you will still need to do some soldering. This will always be a do-it-yourself kit, but that doesn't mean I can't make it super easy to assemble. I haven't soldered in the OLED screen connector either, but I bet if I just plug it into the holes and tilt it a bit, we might see some life on reset. And there it is. It works perfectly. Since the last video, I fixed the I2C scanner, so let's give that a go. It looks like it's successfully detecting the OLED itself at address 3C, and another upgrade has joined at address 50. How can that be, you ask? There aren't any other chips in sight that weren't there last time, are there? It's easy to miss, but I actually added a whole 64 kilobit of onboard EEPROM memory. While the usual ROMs we use for this project are 24 to 28 pin dips, this little thing is hiding away underneath the parallel ROM socket as a tiny SOT23. This little thing doesn't replace the bigger ones, since a 6502 can't boot from a serial EEPROM, but it does mean the 6502ino finally has a form of persistent storage for saving things. Essentially, a super tiny hard drive. How tiny? Well, a 64 kilobit EEPROM can actually hold the whole address space the 6507 can address, for instance. It can also hold an amazing 512 copies of the whole RAM, or quite a few Flavilaris high scores. or we can use it to save lots of tiny little code snippets. You'd be surprised how much you can get out of 6502 assembly if you also have a ROM full of routines to choose from. I'm not sure what I will use yet, but I'm sure it'll come in handy to have some persistent storage on board. Feel free to submit a pull request if you have an idea, or just come say hi in the Hackerspace Clubhouse on Discord. Of course, the onboard EEPROM isn't the only upgrade this time around. Switching to USB-C and adding the built-in serial to USB converter has been great, but I noticed there wasn't a whole lot of space left over between the ROM socket and the USB-C cable, depending on how wide the cable is. Because of that, I decided to move the USB-C connector a bit further away from the socket, so hopefully now nobody will have issues finding a slim enough USB-C cable. For the last version, I was also messing around a bit with using the DTR line of the serial port to reset the 6507. A capacitor alone wasn't a good way to pull down the reset line, so last time I decided to essentially make a voltage divider instead, which kinda worked and also kinda didn't for some setups. So I had to advise a few people to cut the JP16 jumper and reset manually. Of course, that wasn't good enough, so I decided to give it a real fix by adding a PNP BJT that can effectively pull down the reset line without shorting the DTR pin when the physical reset button is pressed. I'm not sure it's perfect, since DTR is technically under software control, so some drivers might keep DTR low while the port is open, keeping the system in perpetual reset unless the host driver is configured to only pulse DTR. It works in most cases, and if it can't easily be fixed in software, the option of cutting JP16 is still there. Last but not least, I decided to double the available code ROM space by adding an optional jumper on pin 1 of the ROM socket. For the W27C512 ROMs I usually use, it means you can switch between using the top and bottom half of the ROM, and the same goes for chips like the 28C256s, for instance. It doesn't mean you can access twice as much code at the same time, but it does mean you can have two different versions of the ROM on the same physical chip and just switch between them, like one with support for the ROM programmer shield and one full of games, for instance. If you use a different kind of ROM, the jumper should also make it easier to use it to begin with. There are already other jumpers in place to configure it for most common ROM types. If you're looking to play with a real 6502 computer in 2025, the 6502 Eno is exactly what you need, and it's super easy to get started. And if you run into trouble, there's a super cool community ready to help on Discord. So come say hi. All the design files are available on GitHub, so you can have it made in whatever color you like at a place like JLCPCB, or you can order it straight from my store, link in the description. I can't wait to play more with it this year, and I'd love to hear what you'll do with it. Either way, thanks for watching.